Okay, perhaps we could make a start. Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. This is really one session that I was looking forward to very much, and I am looking forward to it right now because it's the one that speaks about real experience in countries, what they are actually doing. And I'm very pleased to introduce to you the first speaker of this morning, Dr. Shaheen Hussein Koto from South Africa. Dr. Shaheen has in fact done his medical degree in the University of Alexandria in Egypt when people of his stature were unable to advance very much in their education in South Africa. It's been a privilege for me to have known him and known the South African experience very closely since 1994 to this date. Dr. Shaheen has also done a university postgraduate degree in health management, finance and economics, and is today the director of the National Health Information System of South Africa, the directorate of that in the Ministry of Health, where his terms of reference extend over a range of health information systems responsibilities, including telemedicine services in South Africa. Dr. Shaheen.
Thank you. Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Salawatu salam ala Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. It is a great honor for me to be here in Riyadh to present to the King Faisal Specialist Hospital, and I thank Dr. Al-Nuaim and Dr. Sultan for the opportunity to visit you and share our actual experience. We have a lot of problems in the telemedicine implementation, and what I will do is I'll first explain the problems of South Africa and the health service. I'll show you some of the work we've done in the information system and how telemedicine fits into that. I have quite a few slides, so I will not read them, I will go very quickly through them. I'm from the National Health Information System, and we have 10 clusters within the national office. And our cluster is responsible for health information evaluation and research, as well as quality assurance. And we've just launched a patient charter throughout South Africa. The story of the health information system really started 5 years ago. We are a very young democracy. We are half the size of Saudi Arabia in land, and it was the reconstruction and development program that identified the health priorities for this first five-year period of our government. The main health problems, of course, were those of a developing country, and we had the HIV/AIDS epidemic looming. These were some of the health policies we introduced, and we deliver free primary health care at all our clinics. We have built a clinic. In the first year, we had a problem with service delivery in terms of the skills and project management, but we subsequently built a clinic for every working day in the second year of the new government. We also have a big drive towards decentralization and the district health management system, and we had lead projects which included the primary school nutrition feeding program, and we give kids in rural areas selected targeted intervention to allow them to get at least a sandwich, and we call that the President Mandela sandwich. Prior to 1994, we had 14 departments of health, and when I returned from Egypt, I was not allowed to work in South Africa because the Egyptian medical degrees were not recognized by the South African Medical Council. In the 14 health departments, each of them were divided according to the racial segregation, so we had a major problem in terms of administration when we took over in 1995. Again, the major issues were equity and access, and I will elaborate on these. We had to move from curative to preventative, and of course, hospital to community-based. This was a very important strategic decision, and it was fought by all sides in trying to address the equity. Equity in South Africa is more than just access. It's to do with race and gender as well. The problem we started with was familiar to all countries, but we also had data from the previous homelands, and these were what we call the Bantustans. So when we had to collect the data and collate the data, we had it in 14 different tools in almost 11 different languages. The Minister of Health in 1994 then established a series of committees, and our committee, the National Health Information System Committee, is one of the only committees that continues to function. We have completed a health bill, and it will become an act, and the National Health Information System will become a statutory body within the Health Act. Academic Health Complexes was a major committee, and we have a very good resource on the planning and the strategy for the development of the academic health complexes. We have three levels of government in South Africa, and each level of government, or what we call the sphere of government, is totally independent and autonomous. At the national, we have a Minister of Health, and each of the provinces has a member of the Executive Council with their own legislature, and they have a competency in health. In the local government, they also deliver primary health care, so when we do policy, we have to do policies in three spheres. It makes it very complicated, and Dr. Mandil was part of the National Health Information System Committee at the national level, an advisor to the minister and to the Director General of Health. The nine directors general, plus the head of the military health services, sit in what we call the Provincial Health Restructuring Committee. And that is the committee that has taken forward the change in South Africa over the last 5 years. The strategic objective was simple: to develop a national health information system that started at the local, fed into the district, strengthening district management in a decentralized management system, but most importantly, to include the private and the public sectors. We started with subcommittees late in 1994 and 95 when I joined the committee, and I'll talk about the components just briefly. And when we did a human resource audit, we had no people to run an information system in South Africa. So I'm awed and honored to have seen how the system is run here. In the whole of South Africa, when we did the audit, there were 2 to 3 information systems personnel in the whole country to deliver a health information system. When we did a systems availability, every single system we found in the health sector was not connected to a network, and each of the systems were independently developed and had no communication whatsoever between them. South Africa has about 40 million people, and most of the people generate their income in Gauteng, which is where Johannesburg and Pretoria are. The Western Cape is a very beautiful place, and we have a huge coastline. The Northern Cape is very much like the desert areas, and we have a very low population there. You can see the Northern Cape. We didn't know how many people we had, so we did a census projection, and we thought from 1991 we had 42 million people. In actual fact, when we did the census a few years ago, we found we had 40 million people. So the Northern Cape has similar problems of distance and access. And the KwaZulu-Natal, which is the largest province, is also one of the poorest provinces. And Gauteng has a combination of both rural and urban poor. Now, it's very important to realize that we have to maintain, as a health department, the statistics and all the other information according to race. If you look at the infant mortality rate between an African child and a white child, there's a huge discrepancy. And when we did a survey, the first demographic health survey in South Africa, we found that the infant mortality rate was 45. This is much higher than most countries that spend 13% or 10 to 13% of their GDP on health care. Again, if you look at the maternal mortality, if you're an African woman, the chances of dying are very high. For some reason, the Indian woman, or historically Indian women, have a lower mortality, and it's my personal opinion that is because we send the mothers to their own homes for having their confinement. And as a result, they pump them with iron and their mothers take care of them. And we seem to have some kind of cultural practice that allows a lower maternal mortality amongst these people. This is a very old slide. It's when we use the Human Development Index, which is a composite indicator to measure socioeconomic status. And it measures life expectancy, the level of education, and the income. And there wasn't much movement. And really, the only reason I show this slide is to show that 70% of the population versus 10% of the population, and there's almost a 12-to-1 ratio in the income. When you look at it by province, it's exactly the same. The Western Cape, very beautiful part of the world, and there it has the highest human development index. Gauteng is then second. These are the provinces that are very, very poor. If you look at the infant mortality, again, the highest is in the Eastern Cape, KwaZulu-Natal, and Mpumalanga. Mpumalanga means where the sun rises. It's the eastern province. We also have an AIDS epidemic, and we do an antenatal survey. It's an anonymous survey that takes blood from all women that attend antenatal clinics. So we then extrapolate that to the general population. So at the moment, we estimate our population of HIV to be in the region of 12%, 10 to 12%. The epidemic, if you disregard the provinces, this is exactly what the epidemic is doing over the last few years, and we see it leveling off now. We have to wait one more year to see whether we have made an impact or not. As a result, we can no longer use the infant mortality rate. We are now beginning to use the under 5 mortality rate, and both of those indicators seem to be rising in this 5-year survey we have started to do now. When we look at the difference between the infant mortality and the under 5 mortality, there is a bigger difference in the non-urban. And I think the under 5 mortality rate is a more sensitive indicator to your service delivery mechanisms. Across the provinces, again, you see the Eastern Cape, KwaZulu-Natal, Mpumalanga are the poorest provinces, and therefore they have the highest under 5 mortality. Our insurance companies have taken all our AIDS data and put that into new models, and it's a life association, and they see the life expectancy dropping to 45. So all the gains we have made over the last few years is totally wiped out with the epidemic. And I think it's important to realize that if your risk factors as an individual are lower, you should not be penalized in terms of the insurance cover that they give. And all houses in South Africa are bonded to the life insurance companies, and this is a major issue for us. I added this slide to show that the level of education of women dropped the infant mortality dramatically. And one of the problems we have in South Africa, and following the WHO principles of female literacy, we are trying to educate our mothers and trying to help improve the nutritional status of our children. So all our problems are really still very basic primary healthcare problems in the rural areas. We also have this dichotomy between the rich and the poor and the urban and the rural. And you can see, again, in the Western Cape, in Cape Town, in Johannesburg, in Pretoria, we have far more doctors than anywhere else in the country. For some reason, KwaZulu has more pharmacists per 100,000 population. Our production capacity is limited. We have 8 medical schools with a total production of what would be 1 medical school in the Middle East. And our main force then in the health service delivery would be the nurses. We have started a program to bring the nurses up to clinical practice in primary care. One of the subcommittees is standard, and this continues, and we've adopted the DICOM 3 for this first telemedicine phase, but we also have a whole GIS, etc., and we're doing procedural codes, and we have a government system for billing. Again, we've adopted the ICD-10 for disease coding as well as mortality coding, and I'll tell you about that just now. We're also developing smart cards within home affairs and not in-house, and therefore we have to in-house contribute our standards to what would become a national identification system. Coming back to what are the subsystems, and we follow the guidance of the WHO in developing these, and we prioritized in 1994 the priority systems that would make up a health information system. We took a bold step and divided them into 2. And for the first time, we took on administration and finance as being one of the core functions of the health sector. Disease surveillance is still the main surveillance system we have. Our health system surveillance is improving, and we've done a few surveys, but we can't say we have a nutritional surveillance system. We can have one if we had the ability to take all the data and link it to the child from birth to school going. We have huge systems for human resource and finance that are run by the by the government as a whole. And we've completed a facilities audit management, and I'll just show you one slide of that. But this is new facilities that need to be maintained, repaired, replaced, and condemned. And if you look at the whole of South Africa, we've got about 20% of our facilities And these are the hospitals only, the 435 hospitals we have. We have six academic hospitals in excess of 2,000 beds. And of those, a few of them are very, very old. So what we've done now is we've commissioned two major academic hospitals of the size of King Faisal, and they are completely new and they are being built from scratch. This is a CAD system, and it's run totally by Works Department, and so it falls outside the budgeting framework for health. We've gone to the World Bank, and it's the first loan South Africa has taken from the World Bank, because when we did the audit, we found there was a deficit of 800 million US dollars was the maintenance deficit of the hospital stock. Now, Dr. Sultan on the first night explained that we need to start becoming patient-centered and patient-focused, and the patient is our customer. And as a result, a patient management information system was procured for most of our provinces, not all. We did not have the money to do that. So the strategy was to introduce patient registration, a minimum record, electronic record, and patient billing. This would give us some finances and begin to create a momentum in expenditure in the information sector. We required a system that would be scalable, and we said we'll implement it in all facilities, including clinics, and by doing that we would generate a master patient index or a national database. The enabling tools allowed us to adopt the national identification number as the unique identifier for the whole country, and each hospital would then generate a hospital number, and only for certain conditions would the hospital number be linked to the national number. And I said yesterday that we were very lucky to have adopted an infrastructure from the Department of Home Affairs or the Ministry of Interior, where every single adult South African is fingerprinted, and those systems are available at every hospital currently. We're not using them, but we are on the same government data network. So there's a potential for us to work with another department to deliver part of a solution for health services. So we see the integration of all our resources on the patient. And again, in the province, we have a one-stop shop and an intersectoral collaboration between different departments to begin to offer a single service to government, to the citizens by government. Now, we have this project with the Department of the Interior, and it's called the Joint Vital Registration Project. And we used it to try and begin to collect the mortality data and building district catchment populations. And almost every district in South Africa is now demarcated with defined populations. And we're beginning to find out that we need the community, sorry, that's not very clear, the community data to begin to integrate into the National Health Information System. This was the situation a few years ago, and this is the estimate of the number of births we should have in South Africa. And we see 1.2 million births, but when we look on the Home Affairs or the Ministry of Interior computer, we only had 20% of adults registered in South Africa. Again, when we looked at the health services, we were registering a lot of children. So this is some kind of indication of the number of deliveries that occur assisted in South Africa, and I can quite safely say that every South African woman receives at least one, if not three, antenatal visits prior to delivery, and almost 80% of our deliveries are supervised by a health worker. So the strategy was simple. Let's get Home Affairs and health to work together and get the nurses to improve the population register. The situation is the same. We were only recording 50% of the deaths in the country. So if you don't know why your people are dying, you don't know how many people you have, how do you plan for your services? So the Joint Vital Registration Project was created to ensure a master patient index across the country. This is in 1993, and the darker ones are the over 16s, because you are only fingerprinted when you reach 16, and you're only registered to be on the population register when you're eligible to vote, which is 18. So obviously in 1994 we had the elections, and again in 95 we started improving. When we started this project, for the first time in 1998, the under 16 population began to exceed the over 16 population on the population register. And we are a developing country with very developed parts in it. So we have a demography of a population that is a developing demography. As you can see, from 1991 to 98, and that one hasn't been computed, and the next one we found is up there, and this is the number of registrations on the population register. We've almost reached total registration in South Africa, and this is because we have told our people that to register your child as a citizen helps the government to plan and empowers you as a citizen and opens the Bill of Rights and the Constitution to you. When we compute this into the year in which the birth occurred, this line tends to go up, so we do have a declining fertility rate, which is in part due to a very aggressive family planning program we had historically. Again, you see our causes of death, and this is the problem we have. Our data is 5 years old, and symptoms and signs make up more than 20% of our cause of death. And then we have circulatory systems as well as infections as being the major causes. We were not recording deaths from violence. And again, we've introduced a mortuary system in all mortuaries that don't belong to the health department but actually belong to the police. And we're beginning to see that 50% of our deaths are homicide and almost 40% are accidental. This is not a total set, it's just a feel of the kind of data we're seeing. Again, when we look at when these people die, it's Friday, Saturday night, and it's mainly black people, and they really, the average age is very young. But what I respect about this country is you have banned the use of alcohol, and you can see that 60%, almost 60% of the people that die in violent deaths are due to alcohol or high levels of alcohol and violence. The other issue about race in South Africa, if one plans a health intervention, you find that cervical cancer is almost 20% of that. However, when you look closely by race, you find that an Asian woman, cervical cancer second in breast, is breast cancer is higher. Again, amongst the African women and the colored women, it is cervical cancer. So we need to maintain this legacy of apartheid in our statistical systems for a while. So what we broadly have are three kinds of data, and government sees data as being citizen data, transactional data, the financial systems, the human resource payment systems, and spatial planning data. And we in health also have that similar concept, but we hadn't evolved it very greatly. So in the development of the National Health Information System, we've done a geographic information system for the whole country, and this is the Indian Ocean and Durban, and we have a malaria GIS program where every household is geopositioned, and one is then able to actually predict where a particular epidemic is breaking out using these tools. We are still new in using these geographic information systems, but we've geopositioned every health facility and linked all our data to that in the country today. As we think we are winning the war, we suddenly find there are re-emerging diseases. HIV is one. In our case, these are 30-year slides, and we begin to see an increase in the cases of malaria and an increase in the deaths. We're beginning to see an increase in TB, and measles we seem to have conquered, but I'm not sure if we have another epidemic with the amount of people traveling. We've seen a decrease in meningococcal disease, and leprosy is also down, the diphtheria as well. We have an epidemic of cholera at the moment, and it's sitting about there, and it's in the rural areas. And when we went to investigate, we found the local government had cut off the water supply. So it's a payment issue. If they just open the taps and the government pays for the water, then it would be okay. And that is the other problem. We do not respect the right of every citizen to have water, and the Constitutional Court has told the city of Cape Town they must give water and shelter to every single citizen that is in their local jurisdiction. We've also introduced a new vaccine, the Haemophilus B influenza, and I think we're one of the few countries in the world to do that. The polio is down, but the sensitivity of our information system does not pick up any other acute flaccid paralysis. So before the WHO can certify us as polio-free, we need to improve that. I think this is the broad, we're very lucky, this is the broad holistic approach to management in the government. And we are not sure whether this information system will allow us to deliver what we want, but there is a potential even for business in Africa and in the greater ICT. It's very difficult for us when we see the technologies and we have rural areas to start to introduce a new technology. And this is what our minister said a few years ago, and I think it is the South African government's duty to deliver healthcare to our rural people and our poor. So the challenge was, how do we take healthcare closer to the people and we've heard about the information revolution, etc. And after the Information Society and Development Conference, we developed a multi-purpose community center concept. And this is driven by telecommunications, the Department of Telecommunications that are working with us in the telemedicine project. And they see the delivery of telemedicine as part of their duty. So we're very lucky to say in South Africa, the telemedicine program is a joint project between the two ministries, health and communications or telecommunications. An internet cafe selling bread at night and doing fax and photocopying is the concept to bring an infrastructure into, or the telecommunication infrastructure into a rural or urban area and begin to develop skills and entrepreneurial expertise around the infrastructure, a shared infrastructure. Again, multimedia, I think, is important for us, and especially when we have different languages, the ability to talk across languages using multimedia, especially for some of our women that are not literate, to begin to educate them. This is broadly the service delivery imperative of government as a whole, and our government has visited Malaysia and seen the Malaysian examples and has adopted these broad principles in the delivery of services as a government. Again, it's based on all the issues we heard in the last two or three days on access and privacy, and we've just passed a new act called the Freedom of Information Act that allows any citizen to request any information from government, and that documents, including the diary of the Director General or the Minister, can be made available to any citizen on request. Again, the business challenges have been talked about, and it's doing more with less and trying to be cost effective. So broadly, when we started the project, we used this as a broad definition, and the objective was to deliver services, health services, to rural communities. We also have centers of excellence, and linking the primary health care to the center of excellence was the important area. These again are deliverables of any telemedicine system, but we have rural doctors that are out there, and I think their ability to link into the information system is important. So for the rural doctor to be able to access the network, etc., for continuing medical education and what we call clinical development points for his registration or her registration is important. We adopted a framework that was very simple for telemedicine. And once you've put in the infrastructure and you have some kind of PC on either side, the most important is the human resource on either side and the willingness to collaborate. We've adopted a series of peripheral medical devices and different kinds of equipment to link into the system. And this model is standard, and there are many outside. The first phase, we only used ISDN, and we're using the basic rate ISDN, which is really 264K lines with a small communication channel, and in some cases we're planning to upgrade to 2 meg. We've added video conferencing to every facility, so all our equipment is enabled for future distance education. The telecommunication infrastructure is worse in the poorer areas, and in the areas where there are no distances. But the yellow dots are where we have existing networks. And in Gauteng, we've already got an ATM backbone that all the hospitals can link onto. But it's the last mile that's giving us a problem. When we looked at satellite, I'm very happy to have seen the experience you have here in Saudi Arabia. We found it totally impossible to use satellite, and it was too expensive. It was $5 a minute, and we could not afford that. In trying to put a medical model or a health model onto this, you're familiar with the prevention, treatment, and care, and really the whole population is kind of broadcast systems, but this first phase was linking the primary care to the specialist care. Again, one of the parastatals that belongs to the Department of Communication has offered us a broadcast, closed health broadcast channel, and I'll show you a slide on that just now. But this project in phase one was just linking primary care to the center of excellence using ISDN. We completed this project in March 2000, and we have telepathology and teleophthalmology as new applications, and we're struggling with those a little bit, and the cost of the peripheral medical device in those two are enormous. The primary healthcare application was to do antenatal screening and teleultrasound, and this seems to be the one that works the best And doesn't need any computing or PCs. We connect the ultrasounds directly to the video conferencing or the codec, and that seems to be working in most of the sites. This is just a schema of the five provinces, and in one province we've got two projects. In some provinces we just have a single link for ultrasound, and here we have the... it's not a telepathology system, it's a... because of anatomical pathology being so difficult to do by a technician, it's really a cytology. So it's telecytology, and it will evolve as the technicians have the ability to do slides. The software was provided by a company by Siemens, and it's the Medirad. We saw very, very nice software during the phase one tender, but were unable to afford some of it, and some of it was just not presented correctly. So even though we like to take pieces and bits from all over, this was the company that won the tender. It was a consortium of a black company, black empowerment company in South Africa, and Siemens was their main technology partner. We're still having problems with the color of the slides and the data capture abilities of the software. And with ultrasound, like I say, it's the one that we anticipated the most problems with, but we are currently linking on 128, and all those sites can... over the next few months be upgraded to three basic rate lines. We were told in the literature, and Dr. Bashuri is familiar with the literature, that you should start at three basic rates. We also bought two pieces of equipment to ensure that by the time we do phase two, we'd be able to use the AMD set. So we bought two or three of these, and we allowed them to be used. I don't think we will use the fundoscope. It's very difficult, and even I find it very difficult to use. We've also established a research center to develop this primary healthcare workstation, and we hope it will be cheap, portable, and very robust for the African situation. And we hope to see some collaboration in the future with excellent facilities like yourselves, and to learn from your examples and expertise. This is broadly the map, three provinces doing teleradiology, and the architecture is a simple three hospitals send, and that province has one radiologist, that province has one radiologist, and that province has one radiologist. So in actual fact, where there was no radiologist before, they can get an urgent consult done in 1 hour for the teleradiology. The teleophthalmology and the ultrasound, etc., is still being implemented, but works very well in the desert area where the distances are very vast. And between Kimberley and Kuruman, we have community service doctors that have no supervision, and they are beginning to use the equipment. So as phase two begins to kick in, we should begin to see far more wider use of the equipment for distance learning and tele-education. We've got four technical task teams that were assigned to do the following work in developing the key issues, and I'll flip through them very quickly. Under tele-education, the main one is for continuing professional development and also to develop the guidelines for the evaluation of the telehealth care. We've completed protocols for all the applications you've seen, and they're beginning to develop a framework for an electronic record, and we hope to have a collaboration on that with the group here. Legal license and ethics is a major issue, and we hope for some assistance in this. But we've begun to develop a regulatory framework in the code of ethics in the practice of telemedicine. Again, the infrastructure was a major issue, and when we started the project, they said we would not be able to afford this. And I'll just show you some of the costs before I end. Here we have the three teleradiologies. They're three send sites and one receive. That's the price in South African rands, and that's what it cost us. So it cost us about $260,000 for four sites, and that includes a central archive at each of the received sites with full viewing capabilities, and the ability to then do some research on these, because the variables change very slightly on each of them. So I think there's important data here for research, and I will just show you the data, because we do not even have a year's data. I've only got about 6 months and 8 months of data, but the total project cost us about $1.5 million. So we anticipate the second phase, where we hope to get 73 sites, to not cost us as much. And again, we know exactly what equipment we require. The capture devices here were full state-of-the-art laser scanners and digitizers, and we bought slit lamps, for the ophthalmology in KwaZulu-Natal at two of the sites. So the peripheral medical devices, as Dr. Mandila advised us, was one of the highest cost. And the reason that the ultrasound is so cheap, we did not buy any new ultrasound machines. We allowed them to connect the existing ultrasounds to the network. This is just showing you across those provinces, and just KwaZulu-Natal has two projects, the ultrasound and that. And you can begin to see the rental, the usage, the rental, and the ISDN installation. We thought the ISDN installation was going to be the most expensive, but it seems to be quite cheap. The whole project has been funded from a central budget, and it's not really expensive. So ISDN for us has become very cheap. And these are the number of radiology cases we are doing currently. And you can see the average distances are about 100 kilometers. When you look at the actual number of radiological cases versus the telemedicine, we haven't yet begun to use the system fully, but that shows that the local capacity in these areas is sufficient. We then began to look at the distances and the unit usage, and again, one can begin to see that in some areas where there is low usage, you are beginning to lose money. I will conclude in a minute. So we began to look at the distances, and some of our ultrasound are very... Thank you, Dr. Mandil. So some of our distances, because this is one of the debates, is distance important in telemedicine? So some of our ultrasound sites are clinics and hospitals within a 20, 30 kilometer radius of the academic center. And that would allow us to begin to prevent maternal deaths in emergencies. But the whole telemedicine system as implemented currently is not an emergency system. We said that would be done in phase two once all the technical issues had been ironed out. We've done a break-even analysis, but like I say, this data is 6 months and 8 months, and therefore by the end of this year, we hope to share this information with you, and we hope Dr. Bashir will assist us in developing a proper framework for the evaluation. But we're beginning to see that the number of patients you need to transfer to break-even is really dependent on the number of or the distance from the site. And when we compute that again, we find that really the site has to be at least 150 kilometers away before we begin to break even. And this data will be available if you wish to look at it, and we will assist you in any way that we can with the data. So phase one is now complete, and phase two, we hope to bring on the medical schools. And these are the tertiary sites, and we hope to bring all the medical schools on and have a few secondary hospitals, which are our 200-300-bed, 400-bed hospitals, and some primary sites that are, in some cases, 100-bed rural clinics that are really district hospitals. In terms of a tender, we will use video conferencing, and we'll then begin to put desktop versus the room and the suites that we've seen here. And again, the peripheral medical devices will be bought separately by the institution, depending on the application they wish to use. And again, the request for proposals will be done through the NISA committee, and we hope Dr. Mandil will guide us through that. And if any of you wish to collaborate with us in ensuring a common procurement process, we would appreciate the help and assistance. In phase three, we will begin to look at different infrastructure, especially mobile radio and this whole mHealth issues. And we're very lucky in South Africa to have found the military having 16, that's one of the 16 data networks we inherited, and the government has formed a private company to begin to address this need. So the State Information Technology Agency's job is to get all government departments to deliver government on a single window for the whole state. And these are some of our partners, and CENTEC is providing us with a closed health broadcast channel. And Italian Aerospace have promised us two ambulances linked to some fixed station using their satellite. The Australians have offered us consultancies. And Fight for Sight is a project that does ophthalmology between Moorfields Eye Hospital and two or three of our sites in South Africa. And British Aerospace has sent my project manager for a course in London. But all of this has been done by South Africans using the skills we have locally to ensure sustainability in the long term. This is just the kind of closed health broadcast channel, and it will be totally paid for by the advertising by Centec. The one we're looking at with our CSIR is a closed cellular wireless network. It's 20 kilometer cells that are then linked to the internet, and this is the center of the multi-purpose community center where there is no infrastructure. And we have a lot of expertise in this area, and we would be willing to share this, but it's through our CSIR in South Africa. And we see this as being a potential for areas where there is no telecommunication infrastructure. They talk about 2 megabytes. Maybe in conclusion, the telemedicine in South Africa is really a contribution to what our president calls the African Renaissance. And we seek your assistance in helping us to uplift some of our most poorest communities by using the highest technologies. And thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Dr. Hoto. Very informative, comprehensive, and interesting presentation. We will have time for questions from the floor. We're changing the format for the last 2 days, and there'll be discussion after each presentation. So the floor is open for questions. As you can see, the presentation was really quite complete, and it does touch upon some of the issues that were discussed earlier. I thought somebody would ask a question about the information system they have and what they have inherited and what they're trying to do.
Maybe Mr. Chairman, Mr. Co-Chairman, we could have the other presentations being made, and we accumulate all the discussion and questions towards the end of the session.
Fine.
I'm sure people are still in the process of warming up for the day, yeah? don't think you have escaped without questions. We'll come back to you.